Good morning, and welcome to the service of worship with the congregation of St. Matthew's United Methodist Church. My name is Mark Schaefer. I'm the senior pastor here at St. Matthew's, and on my own behalf, on behalf of all the leadership of this congregation, it is my privilege to welcome you to worship this morning. Wherever you have come from, whatever you believe or doubt, however long you have been on the journey of faith, whomever you love, you are welcome here. Today is All Saints Sunday. It is the Sunday in which we celebrate all those who have gone before us in faith, that great cloud of witnesses that informs our understanding of faith. And it is a day we remember those who have died in the past year. So this is a solemn occasion, but it is a joyous occasion as we celebrate the great witness that so many have had in faith. The worship materials can be found by clicking on the links near the live stream, and I invite you to use those materials to follow along in worship. I invite you also to join with me now in the call to worship found in your bulletin. Grace to and peace from God who is, and was, and is to come. Amen. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and ruler of kings of the earth. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen. I invite you to sing our opening hymn number 711 in the United Methodist Hymnal, For All the Saints.
Thank you.
Join with me in reading the opening prayer. We thank you, O God, for the saints of all ages, for those who in times of darkness kept the lamp of faith burning, for the great souls who saw visions of larger truth and dared to declare it, for the multitude of quiet and gracious souls whose presence has purified and sanctified the world, and for those known and loved by us who have passed from this earthly fellowship into the fuller light of life with you, where you live and reign, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. Today is not only All Saints Sunday, it is a Communion Sunday. It is the first Sunday of the month, and so we will be celebrating the Sacrament of Holy Communion, and we will be offering, as we did last week, the opportunity for you to receive Holy Communion in person following worship through our driveway. So we are having a drive-through communion elements distribution. The communion will be here and shared with you at home, but you can come by anytime after the service until noon and receive the elements, the consecrated elements, in the parking lot. And we'll have the same traffic flow we had last time. We come in sort of the backward direction from the normal way the horseshoe works. Other announcements, we are in the middle of our planning for the coming year, and this would normally be during our stewardship campaign. Excuse me. And I want to thank the 57 folks who have already pledged for the coming year, and we appreciate that. We have only about a third of the pledges that we need to have a good sense of where we will be financially in order to plan for our budgeting. So if you have not yet made your pledge, if you have not yet had the opportunity to do so, please do that. All we're asking is that folks commit to doing in the coming year what they have committed to do this year. I know some folks may assume that we assume that that's what you'll do unless you tell us otherwise, but we would really like to have the confirmation. So if you can please update your pledge and confirm that you will continue your current giving, that will help a great deal in our planning for mission and for the other ministries of the church going forward. Information about that will be in the epistle this afternoon, and also you can go to the website and there should be a link right up top to help you make your pledge for the coming year. Are there other announcements that need to be lifted up at this time?
Good morning. We will have youth group this afternoon or evening at 5 p.m. on Zoom. I have sent out the link, so please look for that. Sunday school, we will not have so that your family can drive through and take communion if you like. And also, I have some play dates available. I've gone on one, so it is available in the Circuit Rider, and I do believe it's going to be on the website if it is not already. So sign up for a play date. Thanks.
Are there any other announcements that need to be lifted up? If not, then let us turn our hearts to prayer by joining together in the prayer of confession. Let us pray. Almighty and all-loving God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, you have reconciled the world to yourself. Help us now to be reconciled with one another, that again we might dwell in the warmth of your love. Inspire us with your Holy Spirit to put aside the cloak of pride and put on Christ, that we might forgive and be forgiven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news that Christ died for us while we were still sinners. That proves God's love for us. So in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And as a forgiven and a reconciled people, let us share in signs of Christ's peace with one another, turning to those seated next to you or sharing words of greeting and peace in the comments of the stream. Peace be with you.
Now is our time for joys and concerns. We are asking prayers for Jane's cousin David, and also we are asking prayers for those who are lonely and depressed. With the weather changing and the time change, let's think of those who are lonely and depressed and send prayers. Thank you.
Will you join with me in prayer? Loving and gracious God, we gather on this cold November morning to celebrate the witness of all those who have gone before us in faith. We are reminded through word and through liturgy and sacrament of that great cloud of witnesses from that first generation until the present day, who inform our faith, who guide our understanding, and who call us into service. It is a reminder, O Lord, that we are connected to one another in bonds of fellowship and love, in ways that span the centuries and that span the miles. And so it is, O Lord, that as your church, we come together to lift one another up in prayer and to lift up a broken and hurting world. We pray for all those who are sick, all those who are in need of healing. We remember especially the tens of thousands suffering from COVID, the thousands more being added each day. And pray for healing and for wholeness. We pray that those afflicted might have access to the medical care that they need, that those who treat them have hands guided with compassion and skill, that we might provide loving and supportive community to aid in recovery, that we might also espouse wisdom in our own behaviors, that we might prevent unneeded illness, that we might protect the vulnerable and the weak, that we might spare thousands needless suffering. We pray for all those who are suffering illness within in ways that we cannot see, those who struggle with anxiety or depression, those who face loneliness and alienation, those whose feelings have been amplified by the current crisis, who are feeling cut off from one another. We pray, O God, for healing here too. We pray for practitioners, we pray for counselors, we pray for friends and family, that they might be the resource available to those in need. We pray that we might be better communities supportive of those who suffer from mental illness, better at reaching out to make connections in times of alienation and isolation. We pray for all those going through difficult times, for David, for so many others who are struggling with uncertainty. We pray for the millions still out of work, for those unsure of their livelihood and their family's future, for the parents struggling to maintain work and life balance in the midst of having children at home, for the children who miss their friends and long for community, for all those struggling with the present moment. We pray for the many homeless who will face increasingly difficult conditions as the winter approaches. We pray that we might respond in mission and advocacy, in resource to meet that need. We pray for all those living in poverty, all those living under oppression and injustice, all those struggling for dignity, all those struggling for peace, for freedom, for equality. We pray for our world. We pray especially this week for a nation divided, in which bitter partisan rancor often undermines our sense of being one people. Help us to love our neighbors in spite of our differences. Help us to build true community that is diverse. Diverse in race, diverse in age, diverse in orientation, diverse in ideology, diverse in creed. And help us to see the strength that such diversity can bring. Heal us, O God, in all the ways that we are broken. Heal us in all the ways we are in need. Until that great day comes when the new Jerusalem descends from heaven, adorned for her children on earth, and when sorrow and sighing and death itself are vanquished. And we pray all these things in your holy and blessed name. Amen. We continue in our worship by singing hymn number 2283, For All the Saints in the Faith We Sing.
This morning's first reading from the book of Revelation. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne, and around the elders, and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne, and worshiped God, singing, "Amen. Blessing, and glory, and wisdom, and thanksgiving, and honor, and power, and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal, and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him every day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The word of the Lord. Please join me in the congregational response, Psalm 34. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Look to him and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. This poor soul cried and was heard by the Lord and was saved from every trouble. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. O fear the Lord, you his holy ones, for those who fear him have no want. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. Please join in the gospel acclamation. This morning's gospel reading is from the Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The Gospel of the Lord. Thank you.
morning. I'm so glad you could join us today. So I have a question to start today out. Does anyone have a dog? Yes? And do you think your dog loves you? But how do you know he loves you? Did he tell you? Or maybe he gives you doggy kisses or sleeps with you. Do you think that there are certain times that your dog loves you more than other times? That may seem like an odd question, but I ask it because my dog seems to really, really love me whenever I'm eating something. I'm like his favorite person in the world when I'm eating something. The minute I start eating, the dog sits right next to me and he looks at me with just this cutest little face and his little eyes. It's very sweet. I'm pretty sure he's wanting to make sure I don't choke. What do you think? Do you think he's paying so much attention to me because he wants to make sure I'm chewing my food very carefully? No? Well, why do you think he seems to really care about me when I'm eating? Oh, you think he's hoping I'll drop something? I think you might be right. So, do you think my dog loves me more when I'm eating because I'm doing something that he wants to do too? That he wants to join in with me? You know, now that we've said that, it's interesting that my dog likes me more when he's wanting the same thing I want. Because I think that's a lot like we hear today in the scripture. In the passage, we hear Jesus say that certain people are blessed. Now, the word blessed can mean a couple of things. One thing it can mean is that God is close to us. Jesus then lists some people who are blessed or close to God. And I think that one thing all those people have in common is that they all want something or the same thing that God wants. For instance, the peacemakers want peace, just like God does. The merciful want mercy, just like God does. And then there are those who are hungry and thirst for righteousness, just like God does. You know, God is with us all the time. And Jesus is reminding us that when we want the same thing for ourselves and the world that God is wanting for ourselves and the world, then that is a way that we can better know that God is with us. And the more we know how God is with us, the better able we are to receive God's help to make those things happen that both God and we want. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who reminds us that wanting what you want is a blessing we can share with the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Will you join with me in a moment of prayer? And now, God, may the words which are spoken and heard and in our lives enacted be faithful and true and touched by your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When looking for reflections on death, British farce comedy is not normally the place people would go for insight. And yet, when I think about our attitudes toward death in this country, I cannot help but think of a famous sketch from Monty Python's Flying Circus, in which John Cleese, playing a customer, comes into the pet shop run by Michael Palin, and John Cleese has a complaint. His parrot is dead. The shop owner insists that the parrot is not dead, insisting merely that he is resting. He adds that the parrot, a Norwegian blue, is likely just pining for the fjords. The customer objects. What kind of talk is that? Look, why did he fall flat on his back as soon as I got him home? The shop owner insists that the Norwegian blue prefers sleeping on its back. When the customer points out that the only reason he'd been sitting on its perch in the first place was that he had been nailed there, the shop owner insists that this is to keep the Norwegian blue from escaping. The customer responds that the bird has demised, and when the pet shop owner insists that the bird is once again merely pining for the fjords, the customer says the following. It's not pining, it's passed on. This parrot is no more, it has ceased to be. It's expired and gone to meet its maker. This is a late parrot. It's a stiff, bereft of life, it rests in peace. If you hadn't nailed him to the perch, he'd be pushing up the daisies. Its metabolical processes are of interest only to historians. It's hopped the twig, it's shuffled off the mortal coil, it's run down the curtain and joined the choir invisible. This is an ex-parrot. And what I like about this sketch is not just that it's funny, but it reveals a truth about our culture. We don't like to talk about death directly. And John Cleese's little rant at the end is wonderful because of the staggering number of euphemisms that he's able to employ to say, is dead. And he could have added a bunch more. Kicked the bucket, gone to his great reward, crossed over, bought the farm, departed, deceased, late, lost, no longer with us, gave up the ghost, expired, in a better place, gone home, transitioned, or the most common one, passed away. A friend of mine did research recently and found that the instances of euphemisms has now outnumbered the instances of the word died in formal obituary columns. Now, of course, it's not only death that we have euphemisms for. There are all kinds of things we don't talk about directly, sex, bodily functions, and so on. But it seems that we have special difficulty speaking about death. Do we imagine that if we don't mention it, it won't happen to us? Do we pretend that death will not come to us if we just ignore it? Why is it so hard for us, seemingly, to just say, so-and-so died? Speaking directly was not a problem for the authors of the Hebrew Bible. There are passages from Genesis that make that clear. Thus, all the days of Adam were 930 years, and he died. Thus all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. Thus all the days of Enosh were 905 years, and he died. It's direct, it's honest language, and he died. No mistaking what happened. Adam, Seth, Enosh all died. Now part of that directness, no doubt, comes from the fact of what the Israelites believed. The most ancient Israelite understanding didn't have any belief in life after death. A lifetime was all that one was due. You lived your life, at the end you went down to the grave. You died. Some versions have a Sheol, a sort of shadowy afterlife, but it was nothing like real life. It was just merely an afterimage. Life was in the here and now. And so perhaps it was easier for them to speak directly about death because death was all around them. much the way it used to be in our country, even just a couple generations ago. And it used to be the case that when people died, they died at home. Their bodies were cleaned and cared for by the family before the corpse was taken away by the undertaker. And after that, the funeral, it would be buried in a coffin in a grave at the graveyard. Now, people die in hospitals. And when they die, the family is whisked out of the room. Hospital staff prepare the body, and then the body is transported to a funeral director who places the loved one into a casket so that after the memorial service, it can be interred in a plot in a memorial garden. It's almost like no one has died. And our removal from daily contact with death has removed our ability to talk about death honestly, and that is something we need to do. First, to assist in our grieving. Today is All Saints' Day. It's the Sunday in which we celebrate those who have died in faith before us. It's a time when we remember that vision of St. John the Divine, who wrote in Revelation that a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, that great cloud of witnesses of those who have gone before us in the Christian faith and who have died, the saints. But it's also a time when we remember those who have died in the past year. And it can be a time when feelings of loss, of pain, and sorrow are still very keenly felt. When memories of loved ones who have died can come streaming back and bring with it all the pain that we once felt. So we, as a community right now, as a nation, and even as a world, are in a time of grief. We are in the midst of a global pandemic, and an entirely new virus is wreaking havoc on our communities and our healthcare system and our way of life. We've already lost nearly 230,000 of our fellow countrymen and women to this virus. And who knows how many thousands more will die in the coming days as the winter comes upon us. And right now, a lot of people are going through a tremendous amount of anxiety, uncertainty about the economy, loss of jobs, access to resources, and behind it all looms the specter of a tremendous loss of life. And quite simply, we've seen that the threat of death for so many has motivated us to take the kinds of extraordinary steps that we're taking. Steps of solidarity, steps of self-sacrifice. But in order to face that challenge, in order to face our grief, we need to be able to name what it is we grieve. I submit to you that it is at times like this that talking around the issue does no good. And part of any grieving process is coming to terms with what one is grieving. And the first step toward healing and wholeness is facing the reality of our circumstance head on. That's why it's so important for us, especially at a time like this, to avoid all the trite sentimentality that hides the reality of death. And I understand it. In our own desire, we don't want to harm other people when they're already suffering. And so we engage in platitudes. They're in a better place. Or they're smiling down on us. There are other things that are seemingly designed to distract from our pain. I don't know that those work. I don't know that anyone who's ever mourned someone who's died has had their mood lifted by platitudes. I think we say them because we don't know what else to say. But if any of you is at my funeral, please don't say or let anyone else say, I'm smiling down at them or I'm in a better place. If you feel a need to say something, say, well, Mark is dead, I guess. I will consider that a personal favor. Because sometimes our inability to be honest about death borders on the absurd. I once saw an announcement for a memorial for September 11th, and they referred to an opportunity to remember those who had passed away on September 11th. Folks, I mean, given the number of people who were killed or murdered on that day, it's almost disrespectful to their memory to hide their death in such a fashion. Because if we are committed to justice, Neither the murdered dead of September 11th nor the murdered millions of the Holocaust or those who died in the Rwandan genocide or the Congolese civil war can be referred to as having passed away. Nor can we say that about those who die from famine and disease, from the scourge of poverty. Nor can we refer to the thousands of black lives lost through acts of racist violence and lynching, to the lives that continue to be lost as a result of racist violence. For those, for reasons of justice, we cannot say simply they passed away, nor can we simply say they're in a better place now. If hundreds of thousands or millions should die because of the coronavirus, because we were not willing to take the steps necessary to protect their lives, trite sentiment will not excuse our inaction. It will not excuse our recklessness. Our sense of justice won't allow it. Those multitudes were killed or they died, and the injustices that led to their deaths are not accounted for by the idea of death as a release. In the spring of 2000, a friend of mine from church was murdered. She was stabbed to death in her campus apartment by a neighbor who wanted to drive her car to a party. It was a brutal and senseless crime. It snuffed out the life of a talented and well-liked individual. And on the drive to the funeral, one of the people in the car remarked, "It's good that they're calling it a memorial service and not a funeral. That way we can celebrate, because it's only the body that's dead. The important part still lives on." Now, it's not my habit to pick fights on the way to funerals, so I didn't this time. But I was apoplectic. If the important part still lives on, why are we sad? Why are we even outraged at our friend's murder? See, not to speak honestly and directly about death is an injustice. It's a hardly a fitting remembrance for my poor murdered friend, Allison. See, it's not simply in our language that we have difficulty acknowledging the reality of death. There's little in our ordinary lives that causes us to confront it honestly on a daily basis. Because it's not just that we don't have people born and die at home. So there's nothing in our culture that embraces the reality of death. Even when we have big public funerals, they're often called going home ceremonies or celebrations of life. It's entirely possible to go to one of those things and not ever really hear the word death. Now, other cultures, our neighbors to the south, in Mexico, for example, have holidays like El Día de los Muertos, the Day of the Dead, which takes place on November 1st and 2nd, All Saints and All Souls Day. And this Mexican holiday is a blend of pre-colonial indigenous tradition and Catholic spirituality. And at the heart of the holiday is the notion that the dead are still members of the community, kept alive in memory and in spirit. And during the Dia de los Muertos, they temporarily return to earth. And the celebration itself involves food and costumes and other revelry. The Day of the Dead is an extremely social holiday that spills into streets and public squares at all hours of the day and night. Dressing up as skeletons is part of the fun. People of all ages have their faces artfully painted to resemble skulls, and mimicking the Calavera Catrina, the elegant skull, they don suits and fancy dresses. Many revelers wear shells or other noisemakers to amp up the excitement and also possibly to rouse the dead and to keep them close during the fun. And it's this last point that we see something important, this keeping the dead close. The idea that the dead are still members of the community. See, it's not just that honesty about death and a willingness to confront death help us to remember better those who have died. Doing so helps us better to remember our own faith. See, the great contemporary theologian Jürgen Moltmann observed that modern people no longer perceive the presence of the dead, he said, the way that the people in former times did. And he says this happens for three reasons. He says, first, we suppress and deny the reality of death. and thus we distort the reality of life. Now, I've long noted that we as a culture are squeamish about talking about death, but we're really fond of killing. Because we're not honest about death, we can't be honest about life. Second, Moltmann notes that we no longer perceive the presence of the dead, and thus we fail to recognize the injustices of the dead. He says, we cultivate an amnesia about past injustices. We sometimes imagine that somehow death makes up for all the suffering that someone went through in life. And that's at the heart, really, of my problem with the "they're in a better place" sentiment, is that it lets us off the hook. Oh, poor John. You know, he struggled all his life to find work with dignity. He was rejected a lot by his family and friends. He was poorly treated by his employer, and he died penniless, but at least he's in a better place now. Do you see how that can deflect from our concern about John's struggles during his life? How it might tempt us not to fix those problems, but to consider the account settled and John finally at rest and rewarded. I mean, this is the trick that tyrants have long used to maintain their oppressions. They tacitly acknowledge that they're suffering in the here and now, but it's okay, you'll be rewarded in the next life. It's what the white slave owners said to their enslaved Africans. God will give you blessing in heaven. It's what the czars told the serfs in Russia, that they suffered in the here and now for the promise of eternal reward. This is what oppressors have told countless millions. But it's not true. The injustices of the present are not made up for by death. These injustices remain. And Moltmann's point is that to live in forgetfulness of the dead is to suffocate with them. It's to deny our own mortality, and such denial and irresponsibility numb us to past injustices that were fatal to our ancestors. And he says that the repression of the dead hastens death, and it reveals and hastens our preoccupation with it. But thirdly, Moltmann points out that we fail to connect the hope for eternal life with the hope for a better life here and now. So we've spiritualized away that eternal life. It's generally now seen as some kind of parallel spiritual plane rather than as a restoration of all things in this world. And that's what makes the vision of the book of Revelation so powerful, because the visions of that book are not about some distant future or some other world. They're about this world. Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who've come out of the great ordeal. They've washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple, and the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more, thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This great multitude that no one could count, that John sees in his vision, have come out of a great ordeal. They have not escaped it, they have endured it. And at the end of that same book, we read, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away.' And the one who is seated on the throne said, 'See, I am making all things new.'" At the end of all things comes a renewal of all things. The new Jerusalem comes out of heaven from God to dwell with God's people here.
God defeats death, mourning, sighing, and crying, and pain. Here, God makes all things new. Here. The book of Revelation makes it clear that our visions of life after death have everything to do with the world we live in. It gives us hope. It comforts us in our suffering. It comforts us in our grief. And it holds the present world to account with a vision of what God intends the world to be. Now, not too long ago, somebody online quipped, "What a decade this year has been." And it certainly feels that way, doesn't it? I mean, there's been a lot packed into the 10 months of 2020 so far. And much of what has happened has been a cause for grief and loss. We mourn the 1.2 million people who have died around the world from the pandemic, including the nearly 250,000 Americans who've died. We mourn the victims of police violence. We mourn those killed by white supremacist terrorists. We mourn those killed in all manner of terror attacks. We mourn those who die because they don't have adequate health care. We mourn those who die because they don't have adequate food and shelter. But it's not enough to say that their sufferings are over when the evils and injustices that caused their deaths are still with us. These are those who have gone through the great ordeal. It's not our place to ignore that ordeal or to cease to prevent it from happening to somebody else. It's important to remember those who have died and to keep them close to us, not as a way of denying the reality of death or not of moving on, but as a way of reminding ourselves that the sufferings, that the injustices, that the wrongs that were suffered by the dead are still with us. And as was the case with Abel murdered by Cain, their blood too cries out from the earth to God and to us. So today is a day when we talk about that great cloud of witnesses. But we remember that they're not simply smiling down on us with approval, but they're calling us back to the hard work of the gospel, the work that proclaims a coming kingdom, the work that proclaims a kingdom in which injustice, evil, oppression, sorrow, sighing, and even death will be vanquished, a kingdom in which the words of Jesus will at last be fulfilled. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted.
Alleluia, Alleluia. May all we tell be blessed.
The setting for communion we will be using today is from the Faith We Sing, pages 2257 and following. If you just simply want the liturgy, that's in your bulletin, and also in the hymnal on page 15, I think. This is not our table. This is Christ's table. And Christ invites to his table all those who wish to receive of this holy meal. You need not be a member here or a member anywhere. You need only to be willing to receive the free gift of God's grace that is made available to you this day. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, God of Ruth and David, God of the priests and the prophets, God of Mary and Joseph, God of the apostles and martyrs, God of our mothers and fathers, God of our children to all generations. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Jesus Christ, who lived among us, who knew human pain and suffering. He fed the hungry, he clothed the naked, he healed the sick, he cast out the demons of the afflicted, he shared meals with sinners and others whom no one else would accept. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and slavery to death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks, and he gave it to his disciples to drink, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and in thanksgiving as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all your saints, especially those whom we now name before you. Beverly Burnett. John Coleman. Virginia Dorn. Helen Graham.
Irma Guy, Dorothy Hicks, Ruth Kluth, Martha Legg, Betty Monroe, Ken Oberle, Tom Page, Virginia Shiflett, John Scotes. And those we name in our hearts. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Confidence of the children of God, we're bold to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we, even though we are many, are one, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ, and the cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. If you have elements at home with you, I invite you to partake of them now. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ poured out for you.
Hear those
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our concluding hymn this morning is Faith of Our Fathers, number 710 in the United Methodist Hymnal. Into a world in which the dead are very much present with us, in which their memory, their inspiration, their example, even their suffering goes before us, that we might see it, that we might recognize it, and through it transform the world itself. And as we go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit go with us, now and always. Amen.